A big hearing underway in Washington involving big-time money laundering and a Saudi bank. CNBC's Eamon Javers is on the money trail. And what? This is a pretty amazing story. It involves a lot of money.
Yeah, Aaron, that's right. It's a story of hundreds of billions of dollars in missing money, an epic family feud spanning continents, and now new allegations of weakness in the U.S. banking system. In a hearing on Capitol Hill later this afternoon, an American attorney will unveil the results of a Deloitte forensic accounting investigation that shows, he'll say, that a single Saudi businessman funneled $1 trillion through the global financial system without triggering any investigation by authorities of the source of the money. The attorney, Eric Lewis, a partner with the law firm Bach Robinson & Lewis, will say, quote, that a Saudi financial institution called the Money Exchange ran more than $160 billion through a single bank account in New York without any apparent scrutiny by the bank or the government of the purpose or destination of these massive movements of money. A key account here was held at Bank of America, and Lewis argues that the Deloitte investigation revealed no evidence of any significant due diligence or anti-money laundering investigation by Bank of America of the money exchange. And he says that the lack of the investigation presents a potentially dangerous gap in anti-terror financing efforts by the U.S., although he does not acknowledge that any of the money here was used in actual terrorist activities. And I should just say that we just received a response to these charges from Bank of America, which says, quote, the testimony, which we only learned about yesterday, contains unsubstantiated allegations that are misleading and incorrect. The assertion that Bank of America did not conduct due diligence on this relationship, patently false. So, Aaron, we're about to hear a dramatic allegation coming from an attorney for one of two Saudi families which have been involved in a long-running financial dispute. Back to you.
Well, Eamon, thanks very much. And obviously, the hearing begins at 4, and the case raises big questions about America's banking system. Beyond money laundering, are American banks knowingly or unknowingly still helping terrorism? Joining us from Capitol Hill Live is attorney Eric Lewis, who is testifying at today's hearing, representing the Saudi family that Eamon was just referring to and doing his reporting on. Also with us, Rick Nelson. He is the program director with CSIS, Homeland Security and Counterterrorism. Good to have both of you with us. We appreciate your taking the time. Eric, let me just put the question to you this way. Instead of getting into the specifics of your case, how is it possible that we could even have a conversation about hundreds of billions of dollars going through American banks when we don't know who is moving the money, who they're giving it to, and who's depositing it? Is this possible?
Well, it's the job of the banks to be the first line of defense. And what the banks should be doing is checking the transactions and the transaction pattern and understand the business of their customers. Know your customer and know your customer's customer are the first line of defense against money laundering and against fraud as well. And here we see $160 billion going through a single account. And Bank of America is not the only one. There are other banks as well. The total amount is about $1 trillion. You have a gentleman in Saudi Arabia, Manal Sana, using a common PC Anywhere software who's moving money from various accounts around the world. And there are no inquiries, despite the red flags of a Saudi remittance exchange, remittance company that is making transfers that are vastly disproportionate to any business it should be doing, circular transactions where money's moving for no particular purpose. And red flags should have gone up and should have been investigated. And from all that we've seen, they haven't.
So, Rick Nelson, let me ask you this question. Do American banks have the tools to know who's moving money where and choose to not necessarily check into every single thing, or do they not have the tools?
They do have the two.
Oh, sorry, Rick, go ahead.
I'm sorry. Yeah, Aaron. Well, they've spent billions of dollars on technology and protocols since September 11th to address this issue. This is no small issue. There's millions, almost trillions of transactions through the global financial system on a daily basis. This is a very, very significant and very large problem that they're trying to address. And these individuals who want to get money to bad people are going to work the system to get that money to where they want it to go. So we have to be careful here not to be critical of the banks who have made significant efforts.
Right. Now, Rick, I mean, it's safe to say, I mean, money is still going through U.S. banks to finance terrorism. They're not purposely aiding and abetting. I hear your point. But, I mean, it's happening because it's too difficult to stop.
Well, our banks are part of a global financial system. Our transactions are near instantaneous at times, all the times, and money's flowing globally, and it's just a very difficult problem for the American banking system to address alone. That's one of the reasons why the Treasury Department has been so aggressive in developing relationships with other nations, because for this to be successful against terrorism, it's going to require an international system of protocols and regulations to keep this terrorist financing in check.
Eric, recently, or actually just yesterday, they said that now you're going to have to say any fund amount transferred, even under $10,000, which used to be the limit, you got to say who's moving it where. And when you look at things like the attempted bombing in Times Square, that costs less than $10,000. So is this move to look at even small amounts of cash that are being transferred going to make a difference?
It's a very important step to take. The Treasury needs to have the technology in order to take the data and understand it and find the patterns that are in it. But the banks continue to play a critical role, most important when the account holder first comes in. And you have a U.S. dollar account holder can be based anywhere in the world. And what's critical is that when someone opens a U.S. dollar account in New York, that bank gives the same scrutiny to that account holder and that account holder's business as if you or I walked in to open a business account off the street in Manhattan. And that wasn't done here, and that's what needs to be done when you have money moving all over the world and when you have dollars flowing from elsewhere. American standards need to be applied rigorously, and regulators need to make sure that's being done.
Well, Rick, could we be tougher? I mean, there are certain countries where we know individuals in those countries are still doing things that they shouldn't do, things that could be, giving money to organizations which want to harm America, and we still have relations with those governments and do trade with those countries. I mean, could we step it up and use our leverage more as a country, not just relying on our banks?
Well, absolutely. And again, I do think that you are seeing that happen under instruments such as the Terrorism Financial Action Task Force, where the government, U.S. government, is putting pressure on nations to join and establish protocols and regulations regarding the flow of funds to terrorist organizations. And that's critical. Again, the United States has to do this in a partnership. If we just follow the laws of the United States and alone, and the rest of the global financial system is operating separately, we're not going to stop the flow of money to terrorists. It makes it a very challenging problem that we have to have a global solution to monitoring this this information.
All right. Well, thanks very much to both of you, Eric and Rick. We appreciate it. Obviously, the hearings this afternoon. It's a story we're going to keep following closely, given how so many of the countries where these things go on are
Thank you.
Big trading partners with the United States. Today's Sign of the Times is next. What? Why?